Hello out there. My name is Deacons Ziwa Senyonjo. Coming from Scripture in Uganda, I'm delighted to bring you God's Word from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 11 to 18. It's a scripture about the Good Shepherd. Let me read the scripture. I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hireling and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, beholds the wolf coming and leaves the sheep, and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hireling and is not concerned about the sheep. I am the Good Shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me, even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with the shepherd. For this one reason, the Father loves me, because I laid down my life, that I may take it again. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. Let me use the analogy of renters and owners. Why does this matter? Well, as a matter of fact, it may not matter in any given case, but statistically it matters because homeowners tend to take better care of their property than the renters. It's not a good commentary on human nature, but in general, it's true. Kids get a lot more angry about the misuse of their own bikes than they do about their misuse of others. And adults are a lot more likely to throw trash out of the window of their car than they are to throw it in their own backyard. Our standards for human homes and our own car and our own toys and our own tools is higher than our standards for the things of others. That's not good. It's one of the things Jesus came into the world to change. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 12, Jesus says, "In everything, therefore, treat people the same way you want them to treat you, for this is the law and the prophets." And in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 to 5, Paul still addresses a similar way of treating other people the way we would want them to treat us. But that's the way human nature is, apart from the transforming grace of God through Jesus Christ. And Jesus knew it and used it to contrast his commitment to his own sheep with the commitment of the hired help. Jesus uses a picture of himself in this text as the shepherd, and he pictures his people as the sheep that he owns and cares about. And in verse 12 to 13, he contrasts the way the owner responds to the wolves and the way the hired help responds. The one who is a hireling and not a shepherd, the one who is not the owner of the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hireling and is not concerned about the sheep. To the hireling, sheep tending is just a job. It's just rental property, not your own home. They don't really care about the sheep. They are doing this to earn a living, not because they love the sheep. And so they say, no job is worth your life. If you are just working for a living, then you sure don't need a job that might kill you. So if a pack of wolves attacks your sheep and you are just a hired hand, you run. You don't risk your life and fight the wolves. Who cares about a few sheep? Who cares if the place gets trashed? It's not our house anyway. We understand these hired hands. We've dished it out ourselves at times, and we've had it dished out to us at times. But the reason Jesus mentions these hired hands is to show that he's not like that. He's not a hired hand. He is the good shepherd and the owner of the sheep. Verse 14 says, "I am the good shepherd. and I know my own, and my own know me. The difference is that the hired hand loves his life more than the sheep, but Jesus loves the sheep more than his own life. Four times in this passage, Jesus says he lays down his life for the sheep. Verse 11 says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Verse 15b says, I laid down my life for the sheep. Verse 17 says, for this reason, the Father loves me. Why? Because I laid down my life. And verse 18, no one has taken my life away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. So Jesus is not a hard hand, because the sheep belong to him, and because he loves the sheep more than he loves his own life. When he sees the wolves coming, he does not leave the sheep to be destroyed. He fights off the wolves and saves the sheep. And in doing it, he lays down his life for the sheep. So what's this really talking about? What does it have to do with us if we are the sheep that he loves? What are the wolves then? What is it that threatens to destroy us? There are three destroying wolves, three things that destroy as wolves, mentioned in the Gospel of John. Three wolves that Jesus lays down his life to save us from. First, there is the wolf of sin. In John chapter 1, verse 29, Jesus said, Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Sin is a wolf that destroys the world and cuts us off from God. And Jesus came into the world to draw the wolf of sin off the world unto himself and to die in the place of his sheep. When the good shepherd sacrifices himself for the flock, he becomes like a lamb and bears the sin of many. You can read further in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6 to 12, about the prophecy of Jesus. Secondly, the wolf of death. And thirdly, divine judgment. Death is a great destroyer. It attacks and destroys everyone, great and small, rich and poor, men and women, every race, every creed. It is an omnivorous wolf of destruction. And after death, the Bible says, comes judgment, which is the third wolf. It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, judgment. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Death does not destroy by ending what we had planned in this life and leading to nothingness. It destroys by ending what we had planned in this life and leading us into the courtroom of God, whose law we have broken and whose glory we have despised. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. But Jesus is not a weak shepherd. When those three wolves threaten his sheep, he lays down his life to destroy them and to save us from them. He says in John chapter 5 and verse 24, Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come into judgment, but has passed out of death into life. When Jesus laid down his life for the sheep, he saved you and me from the three destroying wolves, that of sin, that of death, and judgment. He saw them coming. He went out to meet them. He drew them away from the flock and gave his life to kill them and take away their power so that they could not destroy the flock. Are the sheep left shepherdless then? No. If the story ended here, there would be a great problem. If a flock of sheep lose their shepherd because he laid down his life to save them from a pack of wolves, they are now shepherdless. And even if no more wolves come, they will soon wander or later run off into the green pasture and wander away into the desert valleys of death and perish. And in the end, they will not be saved, and the death of the shepherd will have been in vain. But the story doesn't end with a mangled shepherd lying dead among three dead wolves and sheep scattered, thirsting and starving in the desert. Verse 18 tells us why. It says, No one has taken away my life from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. Jesus' authority and Jesus' triumph is when Jesus came into the world to save his sheep from sin and death and judgment. He came with a commandment from his Father in heaven. The commandment was that he should die for sinners and rise again. And with the commandment came the authority to do it. I have authority to lay down my life, and I have authority to take it up again. He decided by his own authority when he would give himself into the jaws of sin and death and judgment. And after he had lain among the slain for 3 days, Scripture tells us he alone had the authority to take back his life again. And when he did, it became clear for all who would see that the battle had not been a draw, with sin and death and judgment just as triumphant as Jesus. He alone had authority as the Son of God to take back his life, and therefore he alone was triumphant. Sin and death and judgment can never again destroy the sheep of Jesus. But not only that, the sheep now have a shepherd. Christianity is not merely being saved from sin and death and judgment. It also means having a living shepherd to guide you and feed you and heal you and protect you and love you. The words of verse 14 are astonishing. If you've ever dreamed of a deep, deep, deep relationship, I know my own and my own know me, even as the Father knows me and I know the Father. Jesus took his life back from death so that he might have that kind of personal relationship with all his sheep. I know them and they know me. And the relationship that we enjoy is like the relationship between God, the Father, and the Son. And therefore, there is no deeper, no more satisfying relationship in the world that is better than the eternal relationship between God the Father and God the Son. There is more. He took back his life from sin and death and judgment, not only to prove that he and not they were triumphant, not only to give himself for the sake of the sheep in the deepest personal relationship, but also because now he has a worldwide mission to fulfill with the very authority with which he rose from the dead. Verse 16 says, "And I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with one shepherd." Jesus didn't come into this world to lay down his life only for a few Jewish disciples in Palestine. He has other sheep that are not of that fold. He has sheep in Antioch, in Athens, in Rome, in Cairo, in London, in Mbale, in Kampala, in Mexico, in Sao Paulo, in Tokyo, in Beijing, in Singapore, in Kabul, in Tahrir, in Moscow, and many other places. And he's not in the grave waiting to see if there might be enough recruits to bring him out. He is the living shepherd, triumphant over death, and with authority over all the world to gather his own sheep and all the peoples of the world. After his resurrection, he said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations." You can read further from Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 and 19. The shepherd cannot be defeated. And because he moves now through the world with the very authority that raised him from the dead, he cannot be defeated. His sheep will hear his voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. The Christian movement began with a dozen blue-colored men filled with the love and the spirit of the risen Christ. And today, over more than 1.3 billion people from every country of the world give some kind of allegiance to Jesus Christ. And we are perhaps only a few years away from seeing sheep gathered from every one of the 24,000 people groups in the world. The risen Christ cannot fail. He reigns by virtue of an indestructible life with absolute authority over every created reality. And so, the utterly crucial question for each of us this time is, are we sheep? Are we part of his sheep? Are you one of Christ's sheep today? That is, do you hear his voice? Do you follow him? Do you trust in his saving work and promise of his life? This is what it means to be his sheep. John chapter 10, verse 27 and 28 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give eternal life to them, and they shall never perish, and no one shall snatch them out of my hand." I plead with each one of you this day, listen to the voice of Jesus and follow him when he calls you to trust him. You'll not come into judgment, but you will pass from death into life, as John chapter 5, verse 24 would say. May the Lord bless you as you reflect upon that message and think of your part. If you have never accepted him as your Lord and Savior, now is the time. If you have accepted him, you are part of the sheep of God. Are you willing to go out and bring other people into the sheepfold of God? God bless you. Have a wonderful time.